Welcome to the narration of the Mahabharata war, those 18 days. And today we are on the 10th day where one of the most momentous events happened. Many had thought that this was impossible, but it did turn out to be inevitable. It was the fall of Grandfather Bhishma. On the 9th day, the war was severe, and we know how Krishna intervened to protect Bhishma, protect Arjuna from Bhishma. But still, the danger of Bhishma remained. How was he to be defeated? So the only solution the Pandavas realized was that only if Bhishma himself chose to stop fighting. Bhishma was undefeatable. Yudhishthir, on seeing how much havoc Bhishma had caused on that day and how without Krishna's intervention even Arjuna would have succumbed, Yudhishthir started lamenting, maybe this war is futile, maybe we should call off this war. It was something similar to what happened on after day one. But Krishna assured him, said that you are fighting for a virtuous cause and you need to approach Bhishma and ask him how he can be defeated. Before the start of the Kurukshetra war, Yudhishthir had earlier approached his elders seeking their blessings and also asking them how they could be defeated. So at that time, Bhishma had said, the time for my fall hasn't yet come. When the time is right, approach me again and I will tell you. So reminding Yudhishthira of this conversation, Krishna said to Yudhishthira, now is the time to go. And the Pandavas with heavy hearts went to Bhishma. Now how do you ask a person, how can we kill you? And that to a person whom we greatly respect, even revere. So Yudhishthira offered his respects to Bhishma and offered words of praise for all that their grandfather had done for him. And then he acknowledged his apprehension. He said, the way you are fighting, O grandfather, there is no one who can counter you. My forces are being destroyed the way leaves are scattered in a storm. I see no hope for victory as long as you are fighting. And Bhishma nodded and said that, yes, O Prince, what you say is true. As long as I am fighting, victory will be impossible for you. The Pandavas were perplexed. And he said, but I will always fight according to the codes of warfare. And these are my codes. I will not fight anyone who is without armor or chariot. I will not fight anyone who is fleeing, anyone who is seeking surrender, anyone who is a woman. And he gave a list of those who will not fight and he fell silent. Then he put his hand on Yudhishthira's shoulder and he said, I'll tell you what this means. Shikhandi, I know, was a woman in his previous life. He was a princess Amba who somehow had got stranded because Bhishma had got her to marry Dhritarashtra, to marry the Kuru to be rulers at that time. But somehow she had not wanted to marry anyone. It was not the generation of Yudhishthira and Pandu, but the previous generation before that, that is Vichitravirya. So she had given her heart to Shalya and she said, I don't want to marry anybody else. So Bhishma said, okay. But when she went back to Shalya, she said, you've already been abducted by another man, won by another man, lived in their place. I appreciate your affection, but I am a king. I have to set an example. I can't marry. And she said, Bhishma, because of you, all this happened. So you should marry me. And Bhishma refused. He says, I have taken a vow of celibacy. So she felt devastated Her whole life was in ruins. And she considered Bhishma responsible for this. She said that Bhishma should be punished. She beseeched the sage Parshuram, who took pity on her. What can I do for you? He said that Bhishma, that you please kill Bhishma. And Parshuram was reluctant, but then her grandfather had become a sage, and her grandfather requested Parshuram. And Parshuram couldn't refuse the request of a Brahmana. So then Parshuram fought against Bhishma. And they fought fiercely, but Parshuram was unable to defeat Bhishma. When Parshuram was wounded, and eventually before Bhishma could kill, the celestials intervened and he said, he's a Brahmana, do not attack him, do not kill him like this. So then Bhishma desisted, and Parshuram said that, told Amba that I did what I can, and now I cannot help you anymore. Then Amba performed severe austerities to propitiate the gods with one purpose in mind. She said, I want to destroy Bhishma. I want to be I want his destruction. So then she was reborn as Shikhandi, the son of Drupada, and she was destined to kill Bhishma. Now, how was this killing to happen? Because although she had that destiny, but she didn't have the prowess to defeat Bhishma. But Bhishma knew this, and Bhishma said, I see her as who the creator, I see Shikhandi as who the creator had made him earlier. I see non-different, because that same purpose is there. So I will not attack him. He says, place Shikhandi in front and let Arjuna attack me from behind. And I will not attack Shikhandi. And thus you will be able to fell me. The Pandavas departed with a heavy heart. They knew what to do, which they hadn't known earlier. But still, doing it was extremely difficult. Arjuna said that, how can I kill my grandfather? Bhishma, when I used to come after playing, and I used to soil his dhoti, climb on his lap and say, father, father, and he would play with, I would play with his beard, and he would play with, ruffle my hair lovingly. And he would say, oh child, I am not your father. I am the father of your father. How can I kill this grandfather who loved me us like his own children after our father departed from this world? Krishna was grieved. He said, oh Jishnu, that is another name of Arjuna, you took a vow at the start of the battle that you will kill Bhishma. Bhishma has chosen his destiny by siding with the vicious Kauravas. Will you now, O Pandava, flinch from your duty and attain infamy? Toughen yourself and do what is required. Arjuna reluctantly knew that the time had come. The next day, the Pandavas placed Shikhandi at the front of their army, and Bhima and Arjuna flanked him. Surrounding him were other warriors. Now the Kauravas had also got the news. The Pandavas going to the Kaurav camp was not something which could be hidden, even if it was to meet Bhishma. The Pandavas hadn't tried to hide that also. So they knew, and Duryodhan planned that all his prominent warriors should be by the side of Bhishma, and they should protect Bhishma. He tried as far as possible to prevent Shikhandi and Arjuna from even reaching Bhishma. But what was inevitable, what was destined, had to happen. Initially, Dushasan showed great heroism in holding Arjuna back, preventing him from reaching Bhishma. Arjuna fought furiously. Dushasan fought furiously, and eventually, after a great fight where Dushasan resisted Arjuna for a long time, Arjuna eventually lost patience. Arjuna was holding back because he didn't want to kill Dushasan. He wanted to let Bhima do that. But eventually Arjuna lost patience, and he attacked him so Dushasan so fiercely that Dushasan became wounded and fell back. Other warriors came to assist Bhishma. Shikhandi kept challenging Bhishma to fight, but Bhishma neglected him. Shikhandi shot arrow after arrow. The arrows pierced Bhishma. Bhishma turned and glared at Shikhandi as if to burn him with his own eyes. His eyes alone, but he didn't attack him. Arjuna from behind started shooting arrows at Bhishma. And Bhishma started countering those arrows. As the Kauravas, soldiers tried to stop Arjuna and Shikhandi from targeting Bhishma, Arjuna tore their soldiers apart, just broke them down and started destroying them. Seeing this, Duryodhan, who was trying to keep Bhishma away from Arjuna, said, "Oh, grandsire, please protect us, otherwise Arjuna will destroy our entire army today." Bhishma looked straight ahead and then turned to Duryodhan and said, "The debt I owe to you because of having lived in your kingdom, today I liquidate that. I will fight like never before. The vow that I had taken to destroy 10,000 enemy soldiers every day, I have kept that unflinchingly. Today I promise, either I will kill Arjuna or he will kill me." Duryodhana felt jubilant on hearing this. And again he told his warriors that, "Protect Bhishma as he destroys Arjuna." Again, Shikhandi and Arjuna confronted Bhishma. And Bhishma was shot with many arrows. Now, Bhishma countered the arrows that Arjuna was shooting, but he let Shikhandi's arrows hit him. He didn't counter those arrows and he didn't counterattack Shikhandi. But Shikhandi was just not so powerful. Bhishma had armor, so his arrows were not having much effect. But still, seeing the grandsire not countering Shikhandi, Duryodhan sent several of his warriors. He sent Bhagadatta, formidable elephant warrior. He sent Shalya. He sent several other warriors to assist Bhishma. At that time, Bhima intervened. And Bhima stopped all of them. Seeing this, Drona turned towards his son Ashwatthama and he said, "I feel inauspicious amends all around me. I feel inauspicious quivering in my body. Is it that the grandsire's end has come? Oh Ashwatthama, now is not the time to be afraid of one's own safety. Now is the time to discharge one's obligations, to fulfill one's debts to one's elders. Go and stop Partha before he destroys the grandsire." Bowing to his father in assent, Ashwatthama charged toward Arjuna, the place where Arjuna was attacking Bhishma. But Bhima stood like a wall over there. Bhima single-handedly held back all the warriors. No one at all could penetrate beyond him. Finally approaching from another way, Dushyasan, having recovered from his previous defeat and still smarting at the defeat, charged forward and again attacked Arjuna. And Arjuna by this time had worked himself into a reach. Meanwhile, Bhishma was not passive. He was fighting like never before. He seemed like Rudra doing this final dance of universal devastation. It seemed the way Bhishma was dancing on his chariot, swinging his bow, shooting arrows. He seemed unstoppable. And when Dushyasan came towards Arjuna, he fought fiercely. But Arjuna was furious and Arjuna soon hit Dushyasan with such an arrow that Dushyasan was hurled off his chariot and fell to the ground. In fear, he climbed another chariot and fled away. While various generals fought with each other intensely, slowly the sheer ferocity of the fight between Bhishma on one side and Arjuna and Shikhandi on the other side, that was so severe that everybody else fell back. All the supporting warriors on either side were devastated and killed. Shikhandi's arrows kept hitting Bhishma, and Bhishma nonchalantly shrugged them off. Arjuna's arrows thundered into his body. Earlier, Bhishma had told Dushyasan, when Dushyasan was near him, trying to assist him, he said, "The arrows of Shikhandi do not injure me, but Arjuna's arrows are such that even the celestials will not be able to survive. It is only those the arrows which can ever destroy me, which can defeat me, which can kill me." Earlier, Yudhishthir had compared Bhishma to a celestial, and he said that even Indra or Shiva in battle will not be able to defeat you, Bhishma. So how are we going to be defeated? Bhishma was reflecting that point by saying that actually he could sustain the arrows of even the celestials, but not the arrows of Arjuna, especially when he was not countering them. And Shikhandi charged forward, and as the arrows started hitting him one after another, Bhishma fought back fiercely, but Arjuna's arrows kept thundering into his body, wounding him severely. Arjuna broke Bhishma's bow, Bhishma took another bow, Arjuna broke that, Bhishma took another, Arjuna broke that. Bhishma took a lance and tried to hurl it at Arjuna. Arjuna broke that lance also. Seeing all his efforts thwarted, Bhishma looked at Krishna, who was expertly guiding Arjuna's chariot, moving him quickly from here to there, dodging various attacks. Bhishma realized that he could not win. That where Krishna was, there would be victory. Thinking thus, he lowered his bow. At that time, suddenly a fresh breeze started blowing on the battlefield, and the celestials appeared in the sky. Bhishma was one of the Vasus, the Ashtavasus, and those Vasus appeared in the sky and they said, "Oh Bhishma, now is the time to end this war, stop fighting." Bhishma felt a deep sense of peace in his body. Meanwhile, the attacks on him were coming. He had lowered his bow, but the arrows were shooting, thundering into his body. As Arjuna shot dozens and dozens of arrows which pierced his body, wounding him severely, Bhishma was jolted in his chariot, and he looked up. He resolved he would go down fighting. There was no other way for a warrior to die. Bhishma picked up his bow and started shooting arrows. But the combined attack of Shikhandi and Arjuna, with Bhishma unable to attack Arjuna effectively. Arjuna would come out from behind Shikhandi while shooting arrows and again go back. Again come out, again go back. And there was of course opportunity for Bhishma to counterattack. But by this time, he was already wounded. Arjuna's attack was becoming furious. Finally, Arjuna's arrows broke through his armor, wounded him severely. And as all the stunned and shocked onlookers on the battlefield just froze while fighting and watched, Arjuna's arrows hit Bhishma with such force that they knocked him off his chariot and he fell on the ground. But there were so many arrows that had already pierced his body, not a limb of his body touched the ground. He fell on a bed of arrows. The word bed is used here, but that was quite the opposite of any bed. You can scarcely imagine the excruciating pain that he must have been experiencing at that time. Yet, he remained conscious. The warriors in the warriors on the earth and the celestial in the sky were shocked. He is such a great soul. How can he die when the celestial bodies, the sun, the moon, are not in auspicious position? Bhishma calmly replied, "I still live." Bhishma had the benediction of Ichchamrityu. Although he was too wounded to fight, he was not yet dead. All the warriors stopped fighting, and Arjuna came respectfully before Bhishma and he said, "Oh, grandsire, what can I do for you? Please command and your wish will be fulfilled." He said, "Oh, Arjuna, just see how my head is hanging here. Please provide me a cushion." But Duryodhan thought of rushing to get some comfortable cushions from the tent. Arjuna shot arrows into the earth and they came positioned exactly below Bhishma's head. And thus Bhishma got an arrow. And Bhishma, although he was severely wounded, he raised his hand in benediction. He says, "This is the cushion that a Kshatriya deserves. Thank you, Arjuna." And then Duryodhana was devastated. He approached Bhishma hesitantly, shamefaced. He had failed this to protect his commander. His foremost warrior was wounded and about to die. Bhishma solaced Duryodhana and said, "O Prince, this is the end. Death is the end that comes upon everyone. And a warrior desires to die heroically on the battlefield. I prefer no other end. And yet, as Bhishma lay there, physicians came to attend to his wounds, and Bhishma said, 'My time is over. I offer a gift to these physicians.'" They were all Brahmin priests who were also physicians. He said, "Send them on their way. I have no need for them." Bhishma gracefully accepted the end, although he still waited. And the next morning, when on the battlefield itself, he was lying on an arrow bed. That part became a safe zone where no one would go and no one would fight over there. He arranged for some guards were arranged by Duryodhana to be around Bhishma so that jackals and vultures who might come on the battlefield to feast on the corpses would not trouble Bhishma. The next morning, both sides' warriors came to offer their respects to Bhishma. And Bhishma made one fervent appeal to Duryodhana. "O Prince, let the hostilities end with my death. You know what my fall means. You will not be able to defeat the Pandavas. Give them their half of the kingdom. Accept the proposal that Krishna had come with and stop the destruction of the Kuru dynasty." Duryodhana remained silent and then he walked away. He was too stubborn. Although Bhishma had fallen and he had been shocked, stunned, devastated by that, but now Karna was there with him. And he thought that Karna would do what Bhishma had not done. And now he had, although he had seen how furiously Bhishma had been fighting, but now he attributed Bhishma's fall to his soft-heartedness in fighting with Arjuna. And thus he continued the war. And Bhishma just calmly accepted what was happening, knowing that it was the will of destiny. So here in Bhishma's remarkable life, where he had fought so many wars, always remained undefeated, he had learned so many subjects and guided the ruler of the Kuru dynasty for so long, lived a life of sacrifice. And now it came to an end, he accepted it gracefully. And that is remarkable in its lesson. Bhishma's death is the ideal death. Although he died eventually in Krishna's presence, but here itself, when he accepted his destiny, that shows his greatness. The world often tells us that those people are successful who fight against all odds. When the world says no, they fight against it and then they persevere and they succeed and they become great. And yes, that is one parameter of greatness. But to persist through obstacles and go on. But another parameter of greatness is also that sometimes when the world says no, it is a no. It is an irrevocable no. So greatness is seen also in gracefully accepting when the world says no. It is not just in pushing through reversals, but is also accepting that certain reversals may close certain doors. So doing one's duty requires greatness. Persisting in one's purpose requires greatness or manifests greatness. And accepting one's destiny also manifests greatness. And Bhishma, through his life, manifests greatness in both these ways. Such was the glorious life and fall of Bhishma. Thank you. Hare Krishna.